Well, hey guys, this video follows another video I did, my story as an undiagnosed Aspie female, ages 0 to 8, and this will cover ages like 9 through 18. For those of you who haven't seen my videos or know me, I was diagnosed at age 46 as being on the autism spectrum. My official diagnosis is pdd-nos. Which is similar to Asperger's. I just say Asperger's because it's easier and people know what that is. So I'm finding it hard to do this video. I've recorded it a couple times, or started to, and I feel kind of melancholy as I try and talk about it. I don't know, it's just a lot of painful memories and it's hard to share. So I'm going to try and have courage and share some of these things with you. I hope you'll appreciate that because I'm really not wanting to put myself out there, but I think it's important. And if there's a chance that it can help somebody else identify themselves or relate, or to help somebody understand a loved one, then I'm going to take that risk. So I have made some notes, so you're going to probably see me looking away a fair amount at my notes, but there's just a lot of information and I don't want to forget anything. So, with that, I will begin. Well, first of all, I wanted to mention that with my last video, I left something out that I think is pretty interesting or relevant, which is the fact that I sucked my thumb for a very long time. And I was probably about age 8 when I actually stopped doing that. I ended up having really bad buck teeth because of it and a lot of orthodontic work. I now know that that was like a self-soothing behavior. So it makes a lot of sense, you know, with everything I was dealing with the autism and other stuff. And my parents tried to obviously encourage me to stop it, and I finally just realized I had to find a way to do it. So I self-willed myself to do it, and it wasn't easy at all. So I thought that was kind of important. From grades 4 to 6, while I was still in grade school, mostly things were similar to the earlier years in terms of me being, you know, academically strong and me being kind of averse to attention. That didn't change. You know, I was still doing well in school. I was in a gifted program, but like this one program I was in, we were doing like a Shakespeare play, and of course I took like the smallest part with like 2 lines. It's just, yeah, I was too afraid to get up there in front of people. And I think what made it harder at this age was, you know, you're starting to get, like, attention from boys. And that was really uncomfortable for me. I really hated that. Like, I remember one time this boy came to my house. It was probably 5th grade. And, like, he had a little note and a gift for me. But I just felt so awkward, you know. I didn't like that feeling at all. So one of the things I was doing intellectually was chess. My dad was a pretty good chess player, I guess, and he was teaching me chess. And I think he'd been doing that since I was younger, but he told me a pretty funny story that I don't know how old I was, 10 or something, that I actually beat him. And he would never let me win. You know, he always just played straight. And I think that was good because I had to learn, you know. And I beat him, and he said that I just was like running around the house screaming, "I beat my dad, I beat my dad." So I think it's kind of funny, but I wish I could remember chess. I don't remember it at all. Yeah, chess is a perfect game for me because I am very strong in patterns. I'm in the like top 1% IQ-wise for nonverbal reasoning, so it makes perfect sense. But I haven't played it in so long that I can't remember really how to play. Yeah, there's some incidents where, I don't know, at this age, I think kids can start to get a little bit nastier. And it wasn't so much an issue at all with my grade school classmates. I mean, really, I had an incident with kids from another school. And I was very naive because that's what happens with Asperger's. You can't read people, you know. We can be almost very, very childlike, very innocent and trusting. And, you know, it's one of the most painful experiences. I'm not going to tell you, I'm just not, but they basically, like, told me, they lied to me about something, and I ended up doing something that was, like, so just humiliating to me. So humiliating. I can't even tell you. But, you know, now I understand what happened. I mean, it was, that was the naivete of me as a girl with Asperger's, like, trusting people like that. And, yeah, I was just really innocent. Around this time, I started in a certain dynamic that kind of continued through most of my life. I've read that with girls with Asperger's that some of their female friends can go one or two ways. They can either get kind of mothering towards the girl with, you know, Asperger's or autism, or they can be kind of domineering. I do remember around age 11, for a brief time, having sort of this intense friendship with this girl who was just almost like overzealous with me. And it was like intense. And it was, I don't know if it was like that intense mothering, caretaking. But most of my friendships weren't like that. But it started a certain pattern that accelerated in my life. Yeah, and actually, you know, my older sister, she's 3 years older, and she's a very strong personality. And I have this memory. Well, the reason I remember is because my grandfather would always mention this. Always. He would mention when we were little, there was a candy store right where my grandpa lived. And we would go to the candy store, and my sister, like, it was interesting. It was like penny candy. He'd give us like 3 cents each or something. And all the little pieces were laid out, like, in a display. And you could pick. You'd say, oh, I want that one or that one or that one. And my sister would point to a candy, and then I'd go, me too. And then she'd point to another candy, and I'd say, me too. It was me too. And that really epitomizes, I think, one of the coping mechanisms that I had was relying on a stronger female to show me kind of what is right to do. When I got into like junior high and high school, I ended up having some friendships with women who were very strong-willed, strong personalities. And I didn't connect it, but when I talked to the woman who did my Asperger's testing, she really pointed that out, that that's one of the ways I've gotten through is by sort of connecting with some of these strong female personalities, because then it was like, yeah, I almost like had like a guide. So, I don't know. I hope that makes sense. I should mention what was going on at home. My dad, when I was like in fifth grade, was hitting bottom with his alcoholism and finally ended up, you know, getting help for that. And what I found is that sometimes when people stop drinking, they get really, really unhappy because the alcohol is like hiding a lot of feelings and stuff. So it was really hard, really, really hard. Yeah, his kind of extra nastiness and things like that. So my parents eventually divorced when I was in junior high. And then that was a really stressful time. Junior high and high school, in a lot of ways. I don't know what I need to go into about that, but just to kind of give it some context of some of the things I was dealing with. So junior high, boy, that really marks a huge transition of when things started to get really rough for me. And I've read this in books that, you know, they talk about, like, you know, with grade school, it's more about like playing games and things like that. But then you go to junior high and it's just all about the social dynamics, really. And that was so true for me. And, you know, what happened was we had 7 grade schools in the district that merged into 1 junior high. It completely changed all the social dynamics. You know, I didn't have that structure around to be around these kids that I knew so well and trusted and cared about and who I felt safe with. Like, we all kind of splintered off and ended up going in different groups. And, you know, I'd see some of them on the bus. But, yeah, it was really, really hard. And, you know, I wasn't really involved in activities. I didn't know, like, how to do that. I did have a friend who was trying out for the volleyball team. And so I tried out with her, thinking that I would get on it. But I did really bad, and I didn't make the team, and I was so devastated, and that would have been really, really good for me to be able to continue to be with my friend from grade school and have it, some sort of activity. It was just such a bad time with, you know, the divorce and all these structures that I had in place that were gone. I was severely shy to the point of, you know, really almost sometimes being unable to speak. They call that selective mutism when you really are completely unable to speak. It happened to me a couple of times. I didn't have that as much maybe as some other people do, but I did have that. But yeah, I was just so shy. It was awful. Yeah, another thing that started happening in junior high was anorexia. Yeah, I really was restricting my food quite a bit. And I never got so small that anyone ever took notice or cared or anything like that. But I think I would gain weight a little bit and then I would go on these periods of restriction. I was friends with a girl who at this point, like I talked about some of those sort of strong personalities. I became friends with a girl that had a really strong personality. You know, she's a great woman. Nothing wrong with her, but it was just more the pattern of me kind of being the more quiet, smaller one and just kind of looking to her to kind of guide things and lead things. I went into high school and freshman year was still really hard. Things started to get a little better in sophomore year because I had made friends with somebody who said, let's play tennis, let's go on the tennis team. And since I had played some tennis when I was little, you know, I was good enough to barely make the team, you know, like the junior squad or whatever. But that ended up being so good because, again, I had that activity and sort of a structured way to interact with people. And it helped me make some friends. And at that point, I started to sort of get a little more kind of in the quote-unquote popular group, but I was still like I was when I was little. Like, I didn't really, like, discriminate against anybody, and so, like, I'd be the one going down the halls, and I'd, you know, I knew people from kind of all the different cliques, and would say hi to people, you know, it just didn't faze me. I was never into that, so I feel like, unless I'm totally deluding myself, I mean, I feel like I was generally fairly well liked, you know, but at the same time, I just didn't have, like, a really close group of friends myself. Like, I really struggled with that. Like, I was sort of part of this popular group, but then I was also really into math, and I was a mathlete. Like, I was on the math team, okay? So, I was kind of a complex character. I mean, I was, like, an athlete, a mathlete, you know, kind of in the popular group. One year I ended up being a pom-pom girl, which was just so not a fit for me at all. No. I mean, the dancing was, but that was really it. So, yeah, it was just sort of a weird mix. But I felt like I was most comfortable, like, when I'd get together with kids in my math classes and we'd, like, have these math study groups. That's where I felt most comfortable. You know, but yet technically that wasn't my social circle, you know, and even though I was kind of part of this popular group, I wasn't, like, I was alone a lot. I think it was just that lack of connection. I was on such a different wavelength, you know. I was kind of, like, feisty too, like, I don't know. I didn't get into, like, typical gender roles and stuff, so I don't know, I'd kind of get into it with this one guy because he would, like, kind of egg me on about kind of typical gender things and, like, you know, mess with me with that, you know, I would kind of be feisty about that kind of stuff. I did not date really hardly at all in high school. It's hard to talk about this stuff because it's like, I feel like I want to, like, explain it or make sense of it after all these years, and I don't know, like, half the time, I just don't know. I was really suffering a lot of depression and low self-esteem. Yeah, junior high and high school, very bad. I was really, really depressed. But, like, at school, I think I looked okay, you know, and I would have, I guess, do some fun things with friends occasionally, but, like, then I'd go home and be totally alone and be so depressed and just feeling so different, like, something is wrong with me, you know? Like, that's when I started to kind of know something is, in my mind, the words were something is wrong with me. I won't use those words today. Something is just different. I'm just different. I'm wired differently. But I was like, something is wrong. You know, I remember probably in like maybe sophomore year in high school, there was a party, and I guess it was like a makeout party because I go there and everyone's pairing off. And then it ended up being like me and this other girl who are like the only people not making out, you know, with somebody. I was just like, this is just not, I don't know, wasn't my scene. I tried to make it my scene. I ended up, you know, using alcohol sometimes. There'd be parties with alcohol and I'd drink and to try and just make myself more uninhibited and I guess like everybody else, I ended up, I don't know, just doing things that weren't really me. You know, it wasn't in my nature, but I was trying to force myself to be a certain way. Plus, I was really lonely, and I was really wanting attention, you know, and using alcohol, I guess, to get attention. I was still kind of actually a little bit of, like, that rebel. I mean, like I said, I had that feisty attitude in some ways, you know, even though I was, like, so insecure. Like, one year, a female friend and I, we went to the turnabout dance together. Now, I know nowadays kids go to dances in the group, but like back then you didn't do that, and we didn't have dates, we didn't really want to ask anybody, and we went together. I mean, we were the only like two girls there together. That's the kind of thing, like, I just kind of, I don't know, was different, I guess, and I looked really like, I think, conservative and normal and like just like a good girl and all this stuff, but I just, inside, I was just different, and I didn't feel like I connected with 99% of the people that I went to high school with, except, like I said, on some of the intellectual levels, that was the only way, and what was kind of sad was that once I went into junior high, a lot of the creative stuff I was doing really went away, partly because I think my dad was gone, and he was a catalyst for a lot of that, but then also, some of that gets pushed by the wayside for academics. Like, I did have an art teacher, you know, have me enter a couple pieces into a contest, and, like, one got an honorable mention. But I really, yeah, I wasn't as big into art, unfortunately. I wish I had been. I think it would have been good. I was also, like, working a part-time job through much of high school. Didn't have money, really. But now, in retrospect, I really see that this was also starting a pattern of, like, overactivity, of just keeping myself so busy, like kind of this adrenalizing behavior, just to kind of cope. I guess if I was working, I didn't have to sit home alone and feel lonely and depressed, you know. Yeah, I had some really not great experiences, like the few dating experiences I had were not great either. I don't know, being kind of, like, mistreated or me being attracted to the wrong people. And, like, maybe, like, the nicer guys that were interested, like, I just felt so uncomfortable with that. I don't know. I think it was really, really hard for me to, like, how do you let somebody in when it's, like, you feel so defective and you're spending all this energy just trying to be something to cope and survive. Like, how do you possibly even do that? You know, it was just too stressful for me. And then part of the issue was like I said, that attention, like part of me never wanted to have like a real boyfriend because of the attention that that would bring. I think I was probably around age 17 when I asked my mom to take me to see a psychologist. I knew something was wrong. Like I said, I had been having that severe depression. Well, I'd actually been going to the nurse's office a lot, and this could be something that, gosh, I hope people could start to see as a warning sign that something's not right. I went to the nurse's a lot, and I don't know, because it's been so long, like, if I was just, it was physical stuff that was happening, which is very likely because I was still having a lot of physical issues, like I talked about in my last video. Stress-related, you know, I don't know. But I was kind of put down for that. I remember one time one of the nurses saying to me, "This is not normal. This is not normal for a teenager to be coming to the office this often." And I'm like, "Yeah, lady, it's not normal. Something's wrong. You know, some, like, can't you see this is not right? I need help." And, you know, I was still doing the eating disorder too. Like, how it kind of manifested at that point was a little more of kind of overeating and then going on these, like, sort of, you know, kicks of restriction. It just upsets me that no one took me seriously. You know, when I did ask my mom to go to the psychologist, she took me, and it ended up being this older man. And I tried to tell him, you know, something's wrong and, you know, things are going on. And that was the first, like, real time that I was completely minimized. You know, I've shared in other videos the years and years and years of no one listening to me of, "Oh, you're fine. You're just normal. Those are just normal teenage feelings." Like, no, it wasn't. It was not normal teenage feelings. Trust me. You know, so that's why it's so hard to talk about some of this stuff, because I don't even know how to. Like, I'm sitting here and I don't feel like I'm explaining it really well, of just everything that I went through and what it's like going through school and, you know, dealing with everything I was dealing with on top of it, working so hard to try and look and act normal, and knowing something is wrong with you and not getting help and not being believed, you know. I felt pretty hopeless. Yeah, and alone. I really did. Yeah, actually, I was about probably 14 when I first told a friend of mine, you know, the girl I told you about that had kind of a strong personality. I told her, I was like, something's wrong with me. You know, I don't remember the exact words, but I was realizing at that age in junior high, something was not right, and desperate to get help. But I didn't have really anybody I could talk to or anybody that would really listen and get it, you know. Yeah, I was dealing also with, like, a really domineering older sister who was really mean to me. She'd insult me a lot, and was really nasty, did a lot of nasty things, so it was really, really miserable. I feel like I'm so down in this video. I hope you guys can appreciate how hard it is for me to, like, relive all this stuff. And I hope that somehow, some way, I've been able to communicate it so that people can understand. I know that the words are not right, and I'm trying to paint a picture, but I figure I'm just doing my best, and hopefully that's enough to just give you a sense of what it's like, you know. So that's it. I will share more probably about my college years and beyond in future videos. Thanks.